Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So, hello everyone. I'm introducing Zhusheng Xiao. He's visiting myself and Sumit Gulwani here. He did an internship with us last summer where he worked on some natural language processing and translation to Excel. He's also done a lot of work on testing and software engineering, so he's going to talk to us today about some of his work. And he's just about to graduate from NC State University. So, I'll let you go.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, thanks, Mark, for the introductions. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to my talk. I'm going to present my research, Cooperative Testing and Analysis via Informed Decision Making. You are welcome to ask me any questions during the presentations. So software quality includes both functional quality and non-functional quality. Functional quality refers to the functional correctness of the software, and non-functional quality supports the delivery of the functional requirements. Fail to ensure the high quality of software will result in serious consequences. Software with poor functional qualities has many functional defects, which will cause the software to behave incorrectly. Recently, a functional defect caused the Nine Capitals computers to execute a series of automatic orders that was supposed to be spread out over a period of days, which cost the company over $440 million. Software with poor non-functional quality may compromise users' security and privacy. For example, posting your kids' photos using application with geotagging may expose your kids' exact location to strangers. Such security issues are also reported in news. To improve software quality, software testing and analysis tool can be used to automate certain activities in software development and maintenance, which reduce the manual efforts of quality assurance. Among software testing and analysis tools for assuring high quality, text generation tool and code coverage tools are the type of tools that are commonly used in practice. The reason is that generating test inputs to cover a line of code is necessary for exposing faults at this line of code. Although tool automation is important to reduce manual efforts, these tools face various challenges when dealing with complex software. For example, even the state-of-the-art text generation tools have difficulties in achieving high coverages for complex object-oriented programs, since the tools cannot generate desired object states for certain branches and cannot deal with the method calls to external libraries. These challenges will still be difficult for the tool to tackle in the near future. For some of these challenges, users can provide their help to address the challenges. For example, users can provide mock objects to replace the method call to external libraries, help the text generation tool improve the test coverage. However, most of the tools does not communicate information with the users. A little research has been done to support such cooperation. To better support such cooperation, I propose a general methodology, cooperative testing analysis, which allows users to make informed decisions when cooperating with software testing analysis tools. My methodology advocates two types of cooperation. The first type of cooperation focuses on the tools, and users provide their help to address the difficulties faced by the tools. Here, I would like to use the Google driverless car as an example. Given a destination, the Google driverless car will move towards the destination automatically. Along the way, the car may face different kinds of difficulties. For example, the car may enter a cloudy street and does not know how to move forward. In these cases, users can jump in and manually drive the car, help the car to get through the street. After that, the car can continue to move toward the destination automatically. If more difficulties are encountered later, then user can join in and help again. The second type of the cooperation focuses on the users, and the tools help the users make informed decisions to accomplish the task more effectively and more efficiently. Consider the Google driverless car example again. Assume that the user forgets the next destination to go. He may ask the AI assistant in the car to suggest the destinations. Then the AI assistant then reports a list of suggested destinations along with the information of how these destinations are suggested. For example, some destinations may be suggested based on users' preferences. Some destinations may be suggested based on users' current location and previous history. By looking at this kind of information of like how the tools suggest the destinations, provide context for users to choose the next destination to go, enable users to make informed decisions. In cooperative testing analysis, I have made research contributions on analyzing structured software artifacts, such as program source code and execution traces, with software testing analysis techniques. I have also made research contributions on analyzing unstructured software artifacts using text analysis techniques. These techniques focus on assuring the functional correctness, security and privacy, and performance of the software. The structured software artifacts analyzed by my techniques include various types of software applications, such as command line application, GUI application, and mobile applications. The unstructured software artifacts analyzed by my techniques include various types of natural language software artifacts, include such as API documentation, application description, and requirement documents. In today's talk, I will focus on three concrete projects that use two types of the collaborations to improve text generation and mobile securities. I will start with my projects on text generation. So software testing is one of the most widely used techniques to improve software qualities, but it's typically a labor-intensive and costly process. To address these issues, structural text generation can be used to produce high-covering tests automatically. Recently, with the advances of congestion solving, text generation based on dynamic symbol executions has shown promising results in achieving high coverage and detecting real faults in well-tested libraries. Although text generation tools can achieve high coverages on certain problems, these tools face various challenges when dealing with complex object-oriented problems. So here is an example test report generated by PEX. PEX is based on dynamic symbol executions, which instruments the code to explore the feasible paths for generating test cases. Since the number of paths grows exponentially with the size of the programs, which is called path explosions, PEX includes a set of heuristics that guides the exploration to achieve high coverage faster and more effectively. So after the text generation, PEX generates a test report that shows how many test cases has been generated and what are the achieved coverages. So let's look at this example. The achieved coverage of PEX is not that high. Here, I refer to the not covered part of the code as symptoms. So what are the causes to these symptoms? Is it because of the path explosion or what else? To understand the challenges faced by the text generation tools, I conduct a preliminary study on four popular open source projects. I first applied PEX to generate test inputs to achieve coverage. As we can see from the results, the achieved coverage is not that high. Then I manually study the causes to the not covered branches, and I find out that,
What was your setup for applying PEX? I mean, what was the experimental setup? So you had a function, you had an application with say 100 methods. How did you apply PEX?
Okay, so PEX comes with a feature that can automatically generate parameterized unit tests for each public method. So I tried to apply PEX just to generate this program input for this public method.
So it was just PEX out of the box. So you push button, you did no manual effort.
Just let PEX run, yes.
Okay, so when you say apply PEX, there's a feature in PEX that just lets you generate, regardless of what exists already, what tests exist already, you just run PEX on each public method and then collect the results. So this is completely automated.
Yeah, completely automated.
And you haven't done any manual work to this point
to
achieve this coverage.
Right. I haven't done any manual work. Yeah.
I got another question. If you run PEX on a method, if it is doing full symbolic execution, I can imagine that it can continue running forever in the presence of loops and whatnot. So did you provide a time bound, or how did it? How does it decide to stop?
Okay. Yeah. So PEX comes with the preset boundaries for different kinds of resources, like the execution time, a number of branches that you can collect. So I just let PEX run with the default boundaries. Yes. Yeah. So I found out that like most of the not covered branches are caused by two major kinds of problems. The first major kind of problem are object creation problems, where PEX cannot generate desirable receiver or argument objects. Next, I will show how this problem will compromise the achieved coverage. So here is an example class, fixed size stack. This class is a wrapper class of stack. It puts a limitation on the maximum number of objects that can be pushed into the stack. To cover the true branches at line 5, the text generation tool needs to generate a stack object whose size is 10. And here is one of the target sequences that can be used to produce such desired object states. As we can see, there are multiple methods can be invoked on the object stack. And the combination of the method call grows exponentially with the number of method calls in the sequences. Therefore, the search space is very huge, and dynamic body scrutiny tool often cannot easily generate such sequences. Without such sequences, the true branches at lifetime cannot be covered. The second major type of the problem are external method call problems, where the text generation tool failed to deal with method calls to the external library. So typically, text generation tool instruments and explores only methods at the project under test. The reason is that these third-party API methods, they may have too many paths, and the text generation tool will use up the resources in exploring these external methods. Also, some of the external methods, they are not instrumentable. For example, like method call to file system and method call to network IOs. So next, I will use two examples to show how external method calls may compromise the achieved coverage. So let's look at the first external method call file.exist. The return value of this method is used in an if statement. Since the text generation tool does not know the files in your system, it typically cannot generate a value to cause this method to return true. Therefore, the true branches is not covered. Next, let's look at the second external method call, pass.getForwardPass. This external method call slows exception for invalidated inputs. So if the text generation tool cannot figure out how to generate the valid input, this method will keep slowing exceptions, preventing the text generation tool from covering the remaining part of the programs. So for object creation problem and external method call problems, user can provide their help to address these problems. To tackle object creation problems, user can provide factory methods that encode sequence of method calls to produce the desired object state. And the text generation tools can use these factory methods to generate more test cases for improving the achieved coverage. To tackle external method call problems, users can instruct the text generation tool to explore the external libraries. As I just explained, if the external libraries are too complex and containing too many paths, the text generation tool may not still generate desired values. Alternatively, user can provide mock objects to simulate the environment dependencies and enable the text generation tool to generate the desired values for improving the achieved coverage. So to obtain users' help, the tools need to report the problems for the not-covered branches. Given the not-covered branches as the symptoms, the existing approaches will report all the non-primitive program inputs and fields as object creation problems, and report all the executed external method calls as external method call problems. These will become the likely causes to the not-covered branches here. However, these existing approaches face two problems. The first problem is like most of the reported problems are false warnings, which means that if the users provide their help to solve all these problems, a lot of efforts will be wasted. The second problem is
What does a false warning mean in this case?
Yeah, so for example, if I tell you that could you provide a factory method for object type C, and if I provide that factory method, still the coverage cannot be improved, then the user's effort will be wasted.
Okay.
And the second problem is like the existing approach does not know the target state to solve the problems. That is, the existing approach does not know what are the desired object states for solving object creation problem, and what are the desired return values for solving an external method call problems. Without such information, it's very difficult for user to provide their help. For example, a user may provide a factory method that produces a stack object whose size is 5. But these factory methods cannot help the text generation tools to improve the coverage. Therefore, the user may try several times until he luckily provides a factory method that can provide the desired stack objects. Yeah. So to address these two problems, I propose an approach called Kovanas. Kovana precisely identifies problems faced by the text generation tool for the not-covered branches. The insight used by Kovana is that the partially covered conditional statements usually have either data or control dependency on a real problem. So here is the overview of Kovanas. Kovanas first performs forward symbol executions on the program using the generated test inputs. During the test executions, Kovanas observes the runtime events and identifies the problem candidates. This program candidate will become the likely causes to the non-covered branches. After identifying these problem candidates, Kovanas turns the elements of the program candidate into symbolic value. That is, Kovanas turns the non-primitive program inputs and fields into symbolic value, and turn the return values of external method call into symbolic value. Kovanas then performs forward symbolic executions on these symbolic values and collect the coverages and the runtime information. Using these collected information, Kovanas computes the data and control dependencies to prove irrelevant problem candidates and identify the problems along with the target state to solve these problems. So the symbolic execution here is used to compute the data dependencies and the target states to solve a problem. Next, I will use some examples to show how Kovanas identifies external method call problems. So Kovanas considers only external method call whose arguments have data dependency on the program input as candidates. The reason is that other external method calls usually print constant strings or put the thread into sleep for constant times, which does not compromise the achieved coverages. In this example, most of the external method calls have data dependency on the program input and therefore are considered as the problem candidates. Kovanas turns the return value of the external method call into symbolic values and compute the data dependency using forward symbolic executions. In this example, based on the data dependency computation, Kovanas knows that the if statement has data dependency on the external method call file dot exist. Since the two branches of this if statement is not covered, Kovanas correctly reports this external method as external method call problem, along with the target state to solve this problem is like if you generate value to make sure this method returns true, then the not covered branches can be covered. Besides data dependencies, Kovanas also use control dependencies to identify external method call problems. So recall that this external method call slows exception if given invalid inputs. So if Kovanas identifies that this external method call slows exception for all test executions, and the code after line one is not covered, then Kovanas will report this external method as another external method call problems. So far I have shown how Kovanas identifies external method call problems. Here, I would like to show how Kovanas prunes irrelevant problem candidates. So in this example, most of the methods have data dependency on the program input and therefore are considered as candidates. However, none of these methods compromise the subsequent coverage and therefore are safely proven by Kovanas. To identify object creation,
Can't format throw an exception?
Not in these cases. So if like during the test generation, if one of the test execution does not throw exceptions, which means that the test generation tool already can figure out some of the paths that doesn't lead to exceptions. So then the following part of the code can be covered.
Okay.
Yeah.
I see. So what you're saying is that you take the existing set of tests.
Yes.
If within those tests, some methods throw exceptions.
Yes.
Then quote unquote, their summary is that, yes, this may throw exception.
Right.
But within those tests, if a method does not throw an exception, you just assume that this method does not throw an exception.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so to identify object creation problems, Kovanas uses a similar data dependency analysis. So in this example, if the two branches at line 5 is not covered, Kovanas can know that that's because the field stack dot size is not equal to 10. However, if Kovanas directly reports the object type of this field, which is integer as an object creation problem, then it will result in an inaccurate report. The problem is that this field is private, and it can only be modified by invoking the method push and pop. So to address this problem, users should actually provide factory methods for stack instead of integers. How do we address these problems? So given a field, we can actually create a field decoration hierarchy up to the program input. And the problem here is like, which object type the text generation tool failed to generate the sequence of method call for. So if we look at how text generation tools generate sequence of method call more carefully, we can observe that it's not difficult for text generation tools to generate meta calls that invoke constructor, public constructors or public setters to assign fields. Therefore, typically the difficulties lies in the field that is not assignable by invoking these public methods. So based on these observations, starting from the field of the program inputs, if a field is assignable, then the object creation problems is either the field or the field at the next level in these hierarchies. And if the field is not assignable, then the object creation problem is the declaring classes of the fields. So based on these insights, I provide an algorithm to identify the object creation problems from the field declaration hierarchies. I will use this same example to show how my algorithm works.
I'm trying to understand what is the problem. Is the problem that we don't have a model for the push method on stack,
right?
Not fixed size stack, on stack,
right?
That it can modify the count field.
Right.
We don't have that model.
Yeah, we don't have that model.
And we somehow want to recover that.
Yes, yes. So we would like the users to help us to find out that relationship. Because you can, besides push, you can also invoke pop. So then the state would change false and backwards. And it's difficult for the tool to automatically figure out how to generate. Yeah.
Why don't we have the model? I mean, if you have the DLL for the library for stack, can you just read the IL code and
try? Yeah, so basically the text generation, they would try. Like for example, like randomly try invoking different methods. Then but it does not know like whether I should keep invoking this method in order to approach the target state. For example, like he can try to invoke push one time and you see the state increase by one. Then you try the pop again and then it goes back to zero. So yeah.
Can I maybe rephrase the question? So the question is, I have the IL.
Yeah.
I can look at the IL, I can see the internal state.
Right.
So can I just basically muck with that IL, rewrite it somehow so I can just build a stack and set its size equal to a fixed value?
Oh yeah, you can do that as well, but you violate this like object invariance. Yes.
That's not how you set up the problem.
Right.
The way you set up the problem is that you have to generate a valid sequence of methods.
Right. And I think the other thing there is if you assign that field, then it's empty. So if you the next thing here was pop rather than push, it would report an invariant violation there, even though that doesn't make sense from the test case, right?
Yes. Yeah, basically you will generate the invalid object. So then when the people run your test cases, you may cover it, but it doesn't show the real faults.
I mean, but I still think I would like to refine my question further. Supposing I do have the IL available to me, okay?
Right.
So I can make some heuristic judgment based on the knowledge that the push method modifies the count field.
Yeah.
It's not perfect because modification is a very loose thing. I know that in one case it is incrementing it, in the other case it is decrementing it.
Yes.
So I'm wondering if the problem that you are trying to solve is because I don't have perfect knowledge of what push is doing, or is it the case that I don't have any knowledge at all?
It's because I don't know what the push is doing. You actually have that knowledge. You can know like this method modify which field.
Okay, yeah. That's allowed, I see. Okay.
Right.
But you don't know, further refinement, how does it modify it?
Yes. Okay. But actually my technique is orthogonal to this technique because you can always employ more powerful automation technique to solve object creation problem. But in the end, there are still some objects that you cannot figure out. Yeah, and my technique still can applicable in that case to identify the problems. Yeah, so my analysis start with analyzing the field of the program input. In this case, it's a fixed size stack dot stack. So my analysis find out that these methods can be, this field can be assigned by invoking the public constructors. So then my analysis continue to analyze the next field. In this case, it's stack dot size. Since this field is cannot be assignable, then my analysis stops and reports the stack as the object creation problems and ask users to provide a factory methods for these object types. And the target state for these object states is like the field stack dot size should be 10 in order to cover the branches. So to evaluate the effectiveness of Kovanas, I use two open source projects, XUnit and QuickGraph. So I first apply PEX to generate test inputs for these two open source projects. And I fit the programs and the generated test cases to Kovana for identify object creation problem and external method call problems for the not covered branches. I then compare the effectiveness of Kovana and the existing approaches. So I conduct two evaluations. The first evaluation is to show how effective is Cobana in identifying these two types of problems. As we can see from the results, Cobana is able to identify most types of the problems with low false positive and low false negative. And the second evaluation is to evaluate how effective is Cobana in proving the relevant problem candidates identified by the existing approaches. The result shows that Cobana is able to prove that more than 60% of the irrelevant problem candidates, also with low false positive and low false negative. So Cobana enables the cooperations between the developers and the text generation tools.
Sorry, can I ask, so what can you explain what qualifies as a false positive and a false negative?
Yeah, so after the tool generated test inputs, I manually look at all the not covered branches, and I figure out what are the real problems that cause these branches cannot be covered. So and then when Cobana reports our problems, I then try to provide factory method or provide mock objects. If after I do that, if I can cover the branches, then it's true positive. Otherwise, it's false positive. And for the branches that supposed to be object creation problem, but Cobana does not correctly report it, then I will mark it as false negative.
So you looked at all 2,000 of those ones?
No, sorry. This is the one that reported by the existing approaches. Most of them are false positives. But my approach is only report like about 200. So I look at all 200 of them.
Oh, so maybe I misunderstood this. So you said you pruned 1,567 of them.
Right,
and
right.
You saw that there was one false positive and two false negatives?
Yes.
So
yes.
Then you have to look at all of them to make sure that they were the false positives?
Oh, because I look at the not covered branches, and I already know like how many real problems are there. Okay. Yeah, so many of them are actually just false positive by the existing approaches. Yeah. Okay, so Cobana enables the developers to cooperate with the text generation tool. So first, the text generation tool is used to generate the test cases automatically. Cobana then diagnoses the difficulty faced by the text generation tool for the not covered branches and report the identified object creation problem and external method call problems to the users. By looking at these problems, user can provide factory methods and mock objects to address the problems. These factory methods and mock objects are then fed into the text generation tools for generating more test cases for improving the test coverages. So I have shown like how user can cooperate with the text generation tool to improve the test coverage. Next, I would like to show like how tools can help users make informed decisions on how to control their privacy. I would like to use my projects on mobile security for illustrating this kind of cooperations. So with the rapid growth of smartphones and mobile applications, application markets such as Apple's App Store, Google's Google Play, Microsoft's Windows Phone markets has become a primary mechanism for distributing software into mobile devices. And unfortunately, this is also an easy mechanism for malicious users to distribute malware. To protect users' privacy, these predominant mobile platforms provide different privacy control mechanisms. For Google Android, a permission list is shown to the users before the user installs the applications. This permission list shows the permissions that are requested by the mobile applications, and user has to approve all the permissions in order to install the applications. For Apple iOS, a pop-up dialog is shown to the users the first time the application tries to use a permissions. The Windows phones use a mixed strategy that combines both. So although these two approaches are a bit different, both of these two approaches just report what permissions are requested by the mobile applications, but they do not explain how and why they would like to use your permissions. Therefore, users make uninformed decisions on controlling their privacy. Studies show that this simply leads to situations where users just approve of the permissions without looking at what permissions are requested by the mobile applications. So to improve the privacy control mechanism, I propose a user-aware privacy control approaches. Instead of showing the permission list before the user installs the applications, my approach shows the information flow. So this information flow shows what data type flow into what output channels, which can be used to explain how the applications would like to use your permissions. In this example, this information flow shows that these applications will share your locations at Facebook. Here, I refer to the origin of the private information as source, and I refer to the output channels where the private information may escape as a sink. Besides observing the information flows, my approach is provides monitor sync, which are output channels where users can review the information. For example, an application may allow users to take photos using the camera and share it at the Facebook. Before the picture is shared, a pop-up dialog shows the picture for the users to review. In these cases, users are aware of the information that is going to be shared, and also user can perform runtime inspection of the shared data instances. However, there are two challenges in realizing these user-aware privacy controls. The first challenge is that the information flow can escape users' inspections by flowing to non-monitor sync. I refer to such information flow as escaping flows. The second challenge is that the applications can tamper with the data before the data was shown to the users. That is, what you see may not be what you share. For example, an application can encode the location's information into the photos before the photo is shown to the user. Although the user gets to review the picture, it's difficult for the user to notice the small changes. Even worse, the application can encode the location into the metadata of the pictures. In that case, user does not notice the location information at all. Recall that sharing the picture with location information can cause serious security issues. So I refer to such information flow as tampering flow. To address these two challenges, I propose an approach that computes information flows and classifies information flow as different kinds of flows. So to identify escaping flows, my approach is to compute information flows flowing to non-monitor sync. To identify tampering flows, my approach is provides a tampering analysis, which checks whether the data are tampered with before flowing to a sync. And our approach identifies information flow where tampered data flowing to monitor sync as tampering flows. Based on this tampering analysis, our approach does not require users' decision at installation time for information flow where untampered data flowing to monitor sync, since users have the opportunity to perform runtime inspections for these information flows. So our approach is to identify the tampering flow and escaping flows and ask the user to provide their decisions on what kind of information they would like to use for these flows. However, the user may not be sure about whether these flows are expected. So our approach allows user to use anonymized data for these information flows. By using the anonymized data, the user can experience the applications without compromising their privacy. And if the user confirms these information flows are expected, the user can go back and change the accesses to use the private data for these information flows. If the user does not want to provide decisions at all, my approach is would by default use anonymized data for the identified tampering and escaping flows. Next, I will show how my approach computes information flows. So my approach computes information flows statically using object interpretations. My analysis maintains an object state of the applications, an updated state based on the simulated execution of a statement.
You said there was a result that showed that people don't pay attention to those lists of permissions that applications require.
Yes.
It's good that you have a default on here, but if they deny something, it might change the way the application behaves. So is there a scenario where people either don't pay attention or don't care, flip everything to real data, and then they get the whole application experience?
Yeah, they can do that as well.
Okay, so I guess is that as likely as people just reading through the permission list and saying, oh, whatever?
Yeah. Actually, some of the people, they don't care whether you share their location or not. But some users, they don't like, if you would like to share my information, at least you need to let me know. So that's why I have this approach is called user aware. So we need to make user aware of what the application are going to use your permissions.
Okay, you're arguing that this is harder to just ignore, like the original permissions lists.
Yes. Yeah, so my analysis is a summary-based interprocedural analysis. It computes a symbolic method summary for each method and use a fixed point algorithm. Yep.
One more additional question there. Does the application that you're regulating either anonymous or real data to, does it know what level that it's getting?
What do you mean by label?
Could it degrade what it does if it knows that it's getting anonymized data so that it's more likely the user will give it real data so that it can do what mischievous thing it wants to do?
Yeah, I think they can, at the end, the malicious user can observe the patterns of how you do that. But then, like, for anonymized data, you can just, like, choose some random data.
Could, so the application developer wants real data so they can do something bad.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So could they just say, if I'm getting anonymized data, I'm going to make this application just not work correctly?
Yeah,
so if users want to use the application, they have to give it real data, and then the application can do its malicious thing. Is that possible? Does the application have access to what permission level it's been given?
No, the application doesn't know that. But the malicious user definitely can observe some patterns. Like if you keep sending me junk data, then they can block you as well. Yeah. So one way to deal with that is like to generate the random data and then to send to the server. So they may have difficulties in like whether to observe whether this is some fixed data or not. Like you don't just like give a fixed data every time when this API is invoked. You generate a little bit different data, and so they may not be able to detect it. So yeah, but it's not a perfect defense. Yeah, it's just one way to do that. Yeah. Okay. So my approach is provides annotations that can be used to annotate the building APIs. So these annotations are used to describe what are the sources and the sink of the building APIs. And they are also used to describe how the information will be propagated by invoking the building APIs. So the formal definition of the state and how I update the states are in the paper. Here, I will just use some example to show how my analysis compute the states and identify the information flows. So let's look at these simple examples. At line 4, the local variable is classified with the location information. Through line 5 and line 6, the local variables S and P are classified as well. And finally, at line 7, my analysis encounter a sink and identify information flow from the location to the sharings. So besides of these explicit information flows based on data flow and control flows, there are also implicit flows that pose challenges for the information flow computations. So let's look at an example of implicit flows. So at line 3, a message is added to a message collection. And this message is classified at line 4. By using the secret information stored in S. And later in the code, if another message is retrieved from the message collections and is shared via web service, we have a potential flow here. Because the retrieved messages can be the classified message that we classify at line 5. The explicit information flow computation cannot detect such information flow since the message is classified after it's added to the message collection. So the message collection cannot be correctly classified. Such implicit flow propagate information through the containers like array or hash map. There are also other kinds of implicit flows that can propagate the information. For example, an implicit information flow can propagate the information through the file system. It can save the classified information into the file system in one method and send the data out using another method. So to identify the implicit flow based on the containers, my approach is provides an edge to connect the data pipes. So when the message is added to the message collections, my approach is provides a link between message collection and message. With this link, when the message is classified, but the message collection is classified as well. But with such links, my approach is potentially may produce many false positives because the retrieved message from the collections may not be the classified information. So in future work, I plan to report all these locations where my analysis makes conservative decisions and ask the user to confirm whether such decisions are desirable or not. So my current approach does not deal with the implicit flow through file systems. In future work, I plan to use dynamic analysis to identify such flows. So information flow provides the basics for the tampering analysis. The tampering analysis is used to check whether the source, the data are tampered with before flowing to a sink. So the tamper analysis provides a tamper annotation, which can be used to annotate the building API. In this example, the API in code location should be annotated with the tamper annotations. Based on the tamper annotations, the tamper analysis will apply the tamper operator on a set of sources that are associated with a local variable. I will use an example to show how this tamper analysis works. So again, we take pictures using the camera, and here is what the state would look like. The local variable picture is associated with the source camera. If the API encode location is invoked on the pictures, a tamper operator will be applied on the camera sources, indicate that the camera sources has been tampered with. So later when we encounter a sink, my approaches can identify a tampering flow. So I implement this whole approaches in touch develop. I think here everyone knows touch develop it is, what touch develop is, so I will not try to explain it too details. So touch developer allows users to publish and share the applications, which we call scripts in touch develop, through the script bazaars. And these characteristics make touch developer a similar mobile platform to Android and iOS. I evaluate my approaches on about 600 scripts published by about 200 users. So I compare my approaches with the existing approaches and the flow approaches. The existing approaches will require users' decisions for script if both sources and sync are found in the permission list. The flow approaches will require users' decisions if any information flow is found for scripts. Recall that my approaches will only identify the tampering flow and the escaping flow and will only require users' decision for those two kinds of flows. So I conduct two evaluations. The first evaluation is to measure how many scripts require users' decisions. As we can see from the results, there are 172 scripts that use sources. And the existing approaches will require users' decisions for 89 scripts. And this number can be reduced to 78 if we're using the flow approaches. Since our approach does not require users' decisions for information flow where untampered information flow to monitor sync, our approach will only require users' decisions for 54 scripts. The second evaluation is to measure how many sources require users' decisions. As we can see from the results, the existing approach will require users' decisions for 152 sources. And this number can be reduced to 119 by using the flow approaches. By using our approaches, we can reduce this number to 63. This result shows that even with the false positive introduced by the static analysis, our approaches is still very effectively in reducing the user's decisions for the scripts. So far, I have shown that information flow can be used to explain how a mobile application will use your permissions. My joint work with others, Wipers, propose a framework that uses natural language processing techniques to establish links between sentences in the application descriptions and the permission in the permission list. Such sentences can be used to explain why an application would like to use your permissions. Most of this information complements the results of the information flow analysis, and they serve as the first step toward bridging user expectations and the application behaviors. So consider sentences in an application descriptions. Also, you can share the yoga exercise to your friends via email and SMS. The phrases share to your friends via email and SMS implies that these applications need to use your contact information. The reason is that the application needs to know your friend's email in order to send them emails. So I refer to such sentences as permission sentences, since these sentences indicate the use of the permissions. So to identify such sentences, a straightforward approach is just to use the keyword-based search on the application descriptions. So for example, we can just search the sentences that contains the keyword context. However, this keyword-based search approaches face two challenges. The first challenge is that certain keywords such as contact, they have confounding meanings. For example, in the sentence display user's context, the context here means the application needs to read your contact information. However, in other sentences contact me at an email address, the contact here does not imply that the application would like to use your contact permissions. The second challenge is that sentences often describe sensitive operations without actually referring to the keywords. Consider the same example. In these sentences, it does not contain the keywords context, but it implies that this application needs to use your contact permissions. So to address these two challenges, our framework uses natural language processing techniques. So natural language processing techniques help computers understand the natural language artifacts, such as speech recognition and translations. Although natural language processing technique has shown some successes recently, such as the IBM Watson, it's still difficult to use natural language processing technique for general purposes. However, natural language processing techniques is feasible for analyzing domain-specific sentences with specific styles. My previous work on specializing natural language processing techniques using domain knowledges to infer formal models from API documentations and use cases have shown promising results. So in WIPERS, we also specialize the natural language processing techniques using the domain knowledges from the API documentations. So here I will just show the major components of WIPERS. So WIPERS will produce an intermediate representation of the input natural language sentences.
So yep. I'm a little confused. Like, so in the previous slide, you said API documentation.
Right.
And then in this next slide, this sounds like, this sounds like a description from what the app does or something.
Right.
So where are these sentences coming from?
So these sentences are from the application descriptions. Yep. But the domain knowledge are from the API documentation. I will explain that domain knowledge later. Yeah. So first, my approach is use the natural language parser to identify the syntax structure of the sentences, such as like noun phrases and verb group. Based on the natural language parsing, we also produce a dependence tree. So this dependence tree shows the grammatical relationship between the words. It contains more semantic information than a simple syntax tree. Using these dependence trees, our approach is further produce an intermediate representation of the sentences, which is essentially a first-order logic representation. This is also a tree structure. The leaf node of the trees are the entities, and the other nodes are the predicates. So, the children nodes of a predicate are the participating entities, and the first child is the governing entity, and the second child is the dependent entities. So using these intermediate representations and the semantic graph inferred from the API documentations, our approach is identify whether a sentence is a permission sentence. So here is a semantic graph for the permissions read context. So the context is the resources protected by the permissions read context. We also look into the API documentation to identify the attributes of the context, such as the phone number, email, location. These become the subordinate resources of the context. And then we look into the API documentations that require the permissions read context to identify the verbs that represent the action that can be performed on these resources, such as read, search. So to identify whether a sentence is a permission sentence, we search the first order logic representations to find a pair of predicate and entity that match a pair of action and resources in the semantic graph. So recall that in these first order logic representations, the leaf node are entities. So our algorithm starts by matching the leaf node with the resources. In this example, we can find a perfect match, emails. After we found these matches, we start to search the predicate node to try to match the predicate node with the actions, which is basically a verb. So in order to perform the match, we use the word net similarity and the lemmatizations. In this example, we will starting from the end predicate, and we keep going up to search the parent predicate. We also search the sibling predicate if the sibling predicate is the first child, or if the first child of the first order logic tuples. So in this example, if we reach the sibling predicate share of the predicate old, based on the word net similarity, we can find out that these two verbs are very similar. So we find out a matched pair of predicate and entities and a pair of the action and resources and consider these sentences as a permission sentences. Yep.
So what if there was the word not in there? Like, let's say the English sentence was, does not allow you to share your yoga exercises with your friends via email and SMS.
Okay, good questions. Yeah, so our current approaches haven't considered the negative effects. But based on this first order logic representation, we can encode that that domain knowledge into that.
Because a different aspect of this, but similar, is email in the left side of the screen is a verb.
Yeah.
Email on the right side of the screen is a noun.
Yes.
And if you were trying to match up, you said one of the problems in the just using Control F for find was you get the sense of the
right.
of the word wrong, and here you're getting the sense of the word wrong even though you're matching it.
So because this tree is built from the dependency tree, so we already know the email here is a noun, because based on the natural language parsing, I already know the syntax structure of each word.
Sure, but in a way it's a verb because it's a means of.
Yeah, if it's a verb, then it will become
the. It's a verb, essentially.
Yeah.
They parse the sentence with parse features.
Yeah, so we already parse it.
That's not English, that's jargon, email and SMS. That's not English. So this part of sentence parser, unless it's specific to jargon.
Oh, computers.
Know those words.
Due to time limit, I didn't express.
Structure says that has to be enough.
Yes.
Via this and that.
Right.
That, English. Changes things. I don't know. Natural language is statistical, not parsing.
In a way,
you can mess with the grammar a lot.
I think you were going to explain a little bit about how you did the training, so that you
Just
keep going. That's fine.
Yeah. So the email and SMS here is like there is a technique in natural language processing called the name entity recognition. So to improve that the precision of the entity recognition, we also maintain a static list of some nouns that we are commonly used in the domain of the mobile applications. So then we can improve the precision, address the problem. So we evaluate our approaches on 600 application descriptions that consist of about 10,000 sentences. And we achieve promising results in terms of average precision and records. So we also compare our approaches to the keyword-based searching approaches. And the result shows that our approaches can significantly improve the precision and perform slightly worse in terms of recall. Yeah.
What's your ground truth?
Oh, the ground truth is we manually annotate each sentence as whether this sentence is a permission sentence or not.
The human.
Yes, human. Okay. Yes. Yeah, so we show out the result show that we have much better precision, but we have a slightly worse recall. The reason why we have slightly worse recall is because the action or resource pairs inferred from the API documentation cannot cover every cases of how the people will use the API and use these resources. So in the future work, we plan to use some learning techniques to learn from the user comments and the forums to improve the semantic graph And also under our context, precision is much more important. Because if a technique says that this application has the description for permissions, but in the end it doesn't, it's pretty bad. So in our context, we think precision is much more important. So information flow analysis and the wipers enables users to make informed decisions on how to control their privacy. So a privacy control system will give users an application with the application description to inspect. And in my information flow analysis will compute the information flows and identify the escaping flow and the tampering flows. The wiper will also identify the sentences that indicate the use of the permissions. These two kinds of information are then presented to the users, helping users make informed decisions on how to control their privacy. If users are not sure about these tampering flows and escaping flows, users can use the anonymized data to experience the applications without compromising their privacy. So this process can be repeated until all the information flow has been inspected by the users, or the user loses the patience. So I have shown two kinds of cooperations. And the first part of my talk shows users can cooperate with the text generation tool to improve the coverage. And the second part of my talk shows that tools can help users make informed decisions on controlling their privacy. My future work in cooperative testing analysis consists of two directions. So the first direction is economical analysis. So in both types of the cooperations, user may have limited times for each task, and they would like to focus on the more important task items. So for text generation, the benefit, so we would like to have a technique that can estimate the benefit and the cost for solving a task items. For text generation, the benefit is if I solve this object creation problem, how much more coverage can I get? And the cost is like how difficult to solve these object creation problems. For mobile securities, the benefit is like if I grant private data for permissions, what functionality can benefit from it? And the cost is that if I use anonymized data for permissions, how difficult for me to assess these permission uses when I'm using the applications? The second direction is I would like to provide better explanations. So for text generation, I would like to investigate how can I use this visualization tool to improve user understanding of the problem faced by the text generation tools. I also plan to conduct user study to measure the effectiveness of the visualizations. For mobile securities, I plan to investigate technique to review the context of the permission uses. So this context can be used to explain when and where the permission will be used. So certain malicious behavior would be easier for users to notice if their contexts are revealed to the users. For example, a malicious applications may send a text message in the background when the signal strength is changed. So if such context information is revealed to the users, user can easily identify such suspicious behaviors. So my long-term future work in cooperative testing analysis focus on three types of questions. The first question is like what user can do. So currently, I assume users have the same programming skill to provide their help. In reality, users may have different kinds of skills. So I would like to investigate how that factors may affect the cooperation process proposed by my methodologies. The second question is like how can the tools learn from the users? So after the users provide their help to the tool can accumulate the user interaction histories. So later, if a similar problem is faced by the tool, can we mutate this user interaction history to provide solutions to the new problems? So, and the third question is like how to assist the user in providing their help. So I plan to investigate techniques to provide better tool support for the cooperations. For example, currently, users need to provide a factory method from the scratch. But in the future, I plan to investigate like to use program synthesis technique to synthesize partial solutions, and maybe also suggest method call for user to choose in order to construct a factory methods. So to conclude my talk, I've introduced a methodology, cooperative testing analysis, where users make informed decisions when cooperating with software testing analysis tool. I've also shown how this methodology can be used to improve text generation and mobile security. So thanks for coming to my talk, and I'm ready to take questions.
Do we have any questions? We asked a bunch during the talk.
You already asked.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I did have one though.
Yeah.
So on your evaluation of the user-assisted testing, right?
Uh-huh.
So you're using some existing frameworks, including a XUnit, a unit testing framework, right?
Right.
I assume they have unit tests written for XUnit with fairly high coverage. How does the coverage you get compare to the coverage of these handwritten unit tests?
Yeah,
and
so...
Do you have any idea about like how much effort you had to do using the sort of cooperative approach versus, you know, I write all the unit tests by hand.
Right. So basically, if you look at this, like, unit tests written manually, they already encode the method call sequences in order to construct different kinds of objects.
Right.
Sometimes they even provide some factory methods just for testing purposes. So by using my approaches, I also did a small study, like, if I provide factory methods to solve two or three problems, and also like some external method call problems, I can boost the coverage from the 50% to like about 80%.
Okay, and like how does that compare with, if this had unit tests already written for it, how does that compare with what coverage a human can get versus the effort they put in?
Yeah, so if you return it manually, it's possible for you to reach like about more than 90%, but not 100%. Yeah, if you use text generation tools, you provide much less efforts because like the first 50% or 60% were covered by text automatically. And later you just need to provide a few factory methods and then you can also reach that similar levels.
So what would be nice is to say like, okay, I can write 200 unit tests by hand and get 90% coverage, or I can write, just use an automatic tool, get 50% coverage, write three more tests, get to 80% coverage, write five more tests and get to 90% coverage, and then I had eight things I had to do manually versus 200, right? So
yeah.
I'm curious as to what that number is, if you've evaluated that yet.
I don't have the exact data for that. Okay. Yeah, but I think like it's much less help if you're using automated text generation tool.
It'd be nice to have that quantification, especially as an X unit, right? Yeah. I can write unit tests better than you can on unit test right now.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Yeah.
Any other questions?
All right.
Great, thanks a lot.
Thank you, yeah.